God bless his heart.
They had some questions last week.
I think it's great.
Yes.
Amen.
He said they were so attentive and full of questions, and then that's good. We want our kids eager to learn, amen? We are still in 1 Corinthians, and we're starting chapter 7 tonight. How's everybody doing on your Christmas shopping? That didn't sound really great. Y'all sound about like me. You've been having a good week. Amen. Well, tonight we continue in on a very difficult subject, and I'm going to be truthful with y'all. I'll be glad when we just get through this. I'm just trying my best to get through this. There are some things in the Word of God that are just difficult to get through, and I've been thinking, why did I pick 1 Corinthians? Well, anyway, we're going to go ahead, chapter 7, starting at verse 1, and we're going to read 1 through 9 to start off with. Now, concerning the things of which you wrote to me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Nevertheless, because of sexual immorality, let each man have his own wife, and let each woman have her own husband. Let the husband render to his wife the affection due her, and likewise also the wife to her husband. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. Do not deprive one another except with consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again so that Satan does not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. But I say this as a concession, not as a commandment. For I wish that all men were even as myself. But each one has his own gift from God, one in this manner and another in that. But I say to the unmarried and to the widows, it is good for them if they remain even as I am. But if they cannot exercise self-control, let them marry. For it is better to marry than to burn with passion. So, may God bless me tonight. So we know that God established marriage in Genesis, right? And there is a saying, when they write this letter to Paul, they make a statement to him at the very beginning, which says, they are teaching it is good for a man not to touch a woman. And so Paul is specifically addressing this issue in this letter. And which the saying that they have and that they are teaching in the Corinthian church goes completely against what God said in Genesis, which was that it was not good that man should be alone. And God himself is the one that created Eve for Adam so that he would have a companion. Amen? So what they are teaching, and the Word of God does not state whether they came up with this on their own, whether they misunderstood something that Paul had taught them, or whether one of the teachers that they have been gathering to themselves that have been teaching error within the church, if they're one of the ones that started this teaching. But Paul is refuting that and telling them you're going completely against what God taught and what God expects. But he also goes on to talk about the responsibility in the marriage relationship between a husband and a wife. And he places the responsibility of that relationship equally on the husband and the wife. Amen? I know sometimes in a marriage relationship it seems like that the brunt of making the marriage work tends to fall on one person. And the other one just kind of skates by. Amen? And lets the other one do all the work. And this is not what God teaches in his word. But that we should, each of us, put everything that we have into the relationship to make it work. One person should not be struggling. One person should not be doing all the giving and the other one doing all the taking. Amen? But this should be equally distributed within the relationship. He goes on in verse 4 to talk about the fact that we do not have authority over our own body. And I don't want us to get caught up in error in this instance too when I'm saying this, because of course Mike does not have the right to command me to do one thing or another. When it's talking about authority, it's talking about that we should be giving to one another. Amen? It's not, I shouldn't be about everything being about me and what I want and what's good for me and what I desire. But the Bible teaches that my desire, the woman's desire, should be toward her husband, and you should seek to please him and the benefit of what is good for him, and not just within the sexual content, but in all things. What is best for the one that you are in relationship? And this lies equally on both. Amen? So when you're in that relationship, I shouldn't be so self-centered and selfish. It shouldn't always be about, let me just do something simple as this. It shouldn't always be about what I want to eat when we go out to eat. Amen? And thankfully, my husband always says, where do you want to go? And then I turn to him and go, it's all good with me, whatever you want to eat. And he goes, no, I want to go where you... And so it becomes this battle of who's going to win, not making the decision, you know? So, but at the same time, we're not trying to make our demands the only demand. And it should go across in every area. Amen? No matter what we've done, even in ministry, we've always sat down and discussed the pros and the cons, and not talking about what God tells us to do. If God tells us to do something, that doesn't come under discussion. We do what God tells us to do. But if we're planning something in our ministry or whatever, we sit down and we bounce ideas off of one another, sometimes off of our hard heads, you know, but still we're bouncing ideas and we're sharing. And let's take this into everything that we do, not just within the sexual relationship, within the marriage relationship. But he goes on to talk about the fact of why you should not withhold yourselves, because this is a good time for Satan to come in and to cause havoc within a marriage. A lot of times, women, I will say, I would not blame this on men, but women are really bad about saying you can sleep on the couch tonight. And that becomes a bargaining tool and a punishing tool. And I'm sure y'all are getting my gist, okay? So this is not and should not be a bargaining tool or a punishing tool. Amen? God instituted it in the marriage to celebrate the love that you have for one another. And that's the way, and if you love one another, it should not be withheld or given if you please me or you don't please me, or you make me mad or you make me happy. When it comes to that part of the relationship, you don't have the right to withhold yourself, whether you are the wife or the husband. Amen? And like I said, I don't hear this coming from the male side, quite, you know, they just, that's not their thing. Moving right along. Lord, help me, Jesus. Okay, the conditions that Paul gives for abstinence from sexual relationships within the marriage is three things. First, if both partners agree to it. Second of all, if its purpose is for devotion to prayer and fasting. They're sanctifying themselves and setting themselves aside to bring honor unto God. The third thing, if it's only for a limited time. And the reason of this is quite clear, because you're going to find one or the other going somewhere else. Amen? And so Paul says, don't let Satan get into that part of the relationship. Keep that pure, keep it holy. Keep it where it should be and not within your arguments. And I know that's hard, but ladies, let's do better. Okay. Then he goes on talking about the widows. And when he's talking about remain as I am, Paul was not married. He was single. So he didn't have to worry about what a wife liked or what a wife wanted him to do or whether a wife was going to get angry if he went out on a mission trip. He didn't have to worry about anything. He was his own man and could do exactly what God wanted him to do. He was free to completely be God's man. And Paul's whole thing in this chapter and in this book is talking about that the coming of the Lord is soon. And so everything that he taught was with that in mind, that their lives should be lived in a manner that sought the kingdom of God, that sought the coming of Jesus Christ, that they would not get caught up with worldly matters because Jesus was coming back. That's what Christ had told them when he left. I'm going to come back in the same way that you see me leaving. So Paul was saying, if you're not married, don't get married. We don't have time, you know. We need to be about the Lord's business. We need to sanctify ourselves for the work of God. And if you're a woman, you don't need a man lording it over you and telling you when you should be free to do what God tells you. If you're a man, you don't need a nagging wife coming after you and saying, take out the garbage and do this and plant the fields, whatever. You need to be free. So if you're not married, don't get married. Be like me. Amen?
You don't have to worry about me.
Don't have to worry about Marilyn. All right, amen. But he goes on to say this in verse 9. But if they cannot exercise self-control, let them marry. For it's better to marry than to burn with passion. So Paul is saying, if you can control yourself, stay single. But if you can't control yourself and you're going to end up committing fornication or, you know, if you're burning with lust, go get married. Go take care of that problem because obviously you're not going to be about the Lord's business because you're going to be falling into sin. Amen? So go get you a husband and go get you a wife so that you're not burning. And then be about the Lord's business and moving right along. Okay. Hallelujah. I made it through that. Let's go to verse 10 through 16. Ooh, is it hot here? Now to the married I command, yet not I, but the Lord. And Paul makes a distinction between when he is teaching them something that God has commanded and when he's teaching something that he has inferred from the teachings of Christ. Because let's admit, they are facing new things that are coming up that weren't specifically taught by Christ or not specifically mentioned. But you can read the scriptures, and from other situations, you can determine that if God didn't like that, he's probably not going to like this either. And if God was good with that, I think he's going to be good. We can use scripture and apply it to things that it doesn't mention specifically. Let's just take, drugs or whatever. I've had so many people tell me, you know, marijuana is of the plants of the field, and God said that all the plants of the field were good for man, you know. And, you know, we have poppies, little pretty flowers that grow in the field, you know, and produce opium from them, and it's flowers of the field, and God said it's all good. But if you go into the teachings of the Word of God and you start reading about things that harm your body, and you start reading about your body as a temple of the Holy Spirit, and that this body should be sanctified and sacred to be used for the work of God, are you really going to fill it full of opium and heroin and be strung out, you know? Or you going to be so loopy on marijuana that, you know, you're not going to get a speeding ticket? You may get run over, you know, and you may impede traffic from moving, but you know what I'm saying? We have to use some common sense, and we can't twist things for our own purposes, and so Paul makes it very clear when he is making an inference from Scripture and making a common sense decision to teach the church, and when he's simply teaching about a commandment. And in this, he's saying, he's talking about from God. Where am I at now? 11. But even as if she does depart, wait, no. Now to the married I command, yet not I but the Lord. A wife is not to depart from her husband. But even if she does depart, let her remain unmarried or be reconciled to her husband. And a husband is not to divorce his wife. But to the rest I, not the Lord. Now he's saying that is a commandment from the Lord. But now what's fixing to be said next, this is coming from Paul. But to the rest I, not the Lord, say, if any brother has a wife who does not believe, and she is willing to live with him, let him not divorce her. And if a woman who has a husband who does not believe, if he is willing to live with her, let her not divorce him. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, but now they are holy. But if the unbeliever departs, let him depart. A brother or a sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God has called us to peace. For how do you know, O wife, whether you will save your husband? Or how do you know, O husband, whether you will save your wife? So we're going to talk about marriage and divorce a little bit. When the first scriptures that he's talking about, he specifically states believers. He is talking to a couple that they are both believers. They have both accepted Jesus Christ. And he said, if you are both believers, then you are not to divorce, you know. But he goes on to state, if a believer is married to an unbeliever, because you got to remember, this was new. Christianity was new. So there were people who had been married that maybe one in the relationship became a follower of Christ, but the other one was not. And Paul said, if the unbeliever wants to stay with the one who has turned to Christ, then let them stay, because it's best for the children. Because if you have, when he's talked about being sanctified, he's not talking about sanctification that comes from God, which is being set apart for a holy use. What he is talking about, when he said the unbelieving husband or the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the believer, he is talking about when you have someone who lives for God within the household, they are constantly bringing God into that household. And what happens is they begin to rub off on the unbeliever. And they may start turning their life around to where they start lining up in a physical sense, in a carnal sense, start lining up with the things of God. Let's just take it into present day. If they were going out partying and drinking, but their wife stops partying and drinking with them now, and they're a follower of Christ, and they see the life that she's living, and they see the change in her life, well, they don't want to go partying without the wife, so they stop drinking and going partying. Well, what has happened? There's a little sanctification that is taking place in the unbeliever's life. Are they in Christ? No. But their life is getting cleaned up because the believer's beliefs are rubbing off. And the same thing with the children. If there is a believer within the home, there is somebody speaking God over those children's life. There is somebody bringing them to church. There is somebody that's going to show them what being a Christian is about. There is somebody that's going to show them who Christ is and how to find a way to the Father. I just don't want you to get confused with the words, him saying the children are holy and the unbelieving spouse sanctified, because we know from other scriptures, and again, you can't just pull out one scripture. You have to take the Word of God as a whole. And we know from Scripture that the only one who can sanctify us is God. The only one who can make us righteous is God. The Bible says our righteousness, in other words, is as filthy rags. So if I'm the believer and Mike is the unbeliever, I can't sanctify him because my righteousness is just filth before God. So I have no power to sanctify an unbeliever. So that's not the sanctification it's talking about. It's just talking about that cleaning up process that can come from the flow over of God in somebody else's life. And the same thing with children being holy. There's no way that I can make anybody holy. Only God can do that. But it's bringing holiness into their life and leading them to a path of holiness. Amen? All right. He says, if they want to leave, let them leave. And Paul gives three reasons for that also. It says, the believing spouse should not consider themselves to be in bondage. But Christ came to set us free. Amen? And marriage is not slavery. Amen? Because there are a lot of men in this world that consider their wives to be nothing but a slave to do their bidding. Amen? There are women in this world that live in hell because their husbands treat them less than a slave. Amen? And Paul is saying that is not what marriage is about. And you have to go back to those first verses. We are supposed to be giving to the one that we are married to, not taking. Amen? And if both partners are giving, then you're going to have a healthy relationship. But if one's doing all the taking and one's giving, doing all the giving, you're going to have a dysfunctional relationship. You're going to have a marriage relationship that's hurting. Because one person cannot bear the burden and the brunt of taking care of everything. But it takes both giving everything to make it work. Second of all, it says God's purpose is peace. And if you have to fight for somebody to stay married to you, he said, let them depart in peace. Because God has come to bring peace to this earth. Amen? That's his ultimate goal. When he comes back, he's going to bring peace, reigning peace on this earth. And he said, I'm not here to cause a war and a division within the home. But if they want to leave, let them go in peace. And I can't tell you how many people I've seen try to fight and make a marriage work that one person just didn't want it anymore. Right. Amen? You can't make it work. It takes two to make it work. Amen? It takes two to fight and argue, and it takes two to make it work. Third of all, it says, how do you know that by pursuing peace, a believer may have a better chance at winning the unbeliever. Amen? As the believer within the relationship, it is your responsibility to portray Christ, to speak peace into your home. And if the believer is the one that's continually arguing and fighting and bickering, you're kind of defeating the whole purpose. Amen? So you're the one that's supposed to speak peace. Because by doing so, you just might win the unbelieving spouse to Christ. And isn't that the ultimate goal in everything, that we might win others to Christ? But again, you can't. You have to take this and take it all and balance it out. You can't just say, I'm going to give everything I got in hopes that they might come to Christ. If they want to go, if they don't want to be a part of that relationship, let them go. You're beaten at air. Amen? You're beating yourself up for no reason. They're not into the relationship. They don't love you. Let them go if they want to go. They want to stay. The Bible says you got to kind of let them hang around. But but if they want to go, let them go. Amen. And again, I want you to understand that when Paul is teaching about marriage, and that he is addressing specific situations. So these scriptures are not an end-all teaching to marriage. There's a lot of teaching within the Word of God about relationship and marriage. This is just dealing with some specific issues. So don't take this chapter right here and build your marriage on it. Amen? There were problems. There were issues. And that's what he's addressing. All right, let's go 17 through 24. Where am I at? Okay. Let me find 17. But as God has distributed to each one, as the Lord has called each one, so let him walk. And so I ordain in all the churches. Was anyone called while circumcised? Let him not become uncircumcised. Was anyone called while uncircumcised? Let him not be circumcised. Circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing. But keeping the commandments of God is what matters. Let each one remain in the same calling in which he was called. Were you called while a slave? Then don't be concerned about it. But if you can be made free, use that. For he who is called in the Lord while a slave is the Lord's freedman. Likewise, he who is called while free is Christ's slave. You were bought at a price. Do not become slaves of men. Brethren, let each one remain with God in that state in which he was called. Okay, you have to understand that the Christian church right now, people are being won to Christ from all walks and stations of life. And there are some that are teaching, if you were a slave, you're now set free in Christ, so you're no longer under your master anymore. You can leave. Christ has set you free. But this is not true. Paul said, we haven't come to defy the laws of the land. Amen? If you got saved while you were a slave, then you minister where you at. If you can get free, then in that free state, minister as you can. He was saying no matter if you were married or unmarried, if you were slave or free, if you were master or the slave, it doesn't matter. Do God's work wherever it is that you got saved and in whatever state it is that you got saved. Does that make sense to you?
Amen.
Amen. I wanted to read this. I know we've got to close up here in a minute. Talking about circumcision and uncircumcision, there was this big debate within the Christian church. There were some saying that the Gentiles coming into the Christian faith, that they needed to be circumcised because the Jews were circumcised. So to be a Christian, you had to be circumcised. And so there was this big debate within the leaders of the Christian church at that time. And they came up with this. This was the stand that they took. If God saved them as a Gentile and uncircumcised, then God must not have meant for them to be circumcised because he saved them in that state. If he would have wanted them to be circumcised to be saved, he would have commanded that they be circumcised before they could be saved. But if God accepted and called them, and I'm going to bring that right into the church. There are so many times in the modern day church that we don't want to accept people in the state that they're in when they come to us. Amen? But we want to wait until they look like we look and they speak like we speak. Amen? And they dress like we dress and eat what we eat and are just like me, then you can be a part of Christ. And there are so many times there are people that walk within our midst and they're rejected by the church because they don't meet the church standards. And here's the thing. Christ saved people wherever he found them. Christ saved people in whatever state that they were in. He did not make them go be baptized in water before he would redeem them. Amen? He did not make them. He stepped out onto the shores with a demoniac, and he didn't say, okay, y'all got to clean him up and put some clothes on because I'm not talking to the naked man. You know? Because the man was naked when he came out like a raving maniac. But Jesus walked up to the man and ministered to him and delivered him from the demons in the state and in the place that he didn't demand that he be brought to the synagogue and dressed. But right there where he met the man, he met his needs. And as the church, we have really got to get off our high horse and understand haven't bathed in a week, yes, hold your breath and minister to them. Amen? God has brought them in those doors, and the only thing that matters is that we lead them to salvation. If they've got holes all in their clothes, if their clothes are dirty, maybe it's the only thing they own. And God doesn't care, and so you shouldn't. Amen? Let's meet the needs of the people that God sends our way through those doors. And another thing that I wanted to bring out as a close is this. When he's talking about, let me read this again. In verse 22. For he who is called in the Lord while a slave is the Lord's freedman. In other words, if you're a slave, you're free in Christ. Regardless if you're in the state of serving a master, in Christ you are free. But he goes on, likewise, he who is called while free is a slave of Christ. And I wrote this. In Paul's mind, there was not absolute freedom and there was not absolute slavery. Every person is both free and a slave. The question is always this. What am I free from and whom am I free from? And to what or to whom am I a slave to? So each and every one of you in here tonight, you are a slave to something or someone, and you are free. We need to determine, am I a slave of Christ, or am I a slave unto sin? We're going to be a slave of one or the other. The Bible says that either the Lord is your master or Satan is your master. That means you're going to be the slave of one or the other, the servant of one or the other. What we have to determine is, who is it that we're serving? Amen. Who am I a servant of? The Lord Most High? Or am I doing the bidding of Satan in my life? So you are free and you are a slave. Choose who you're going to serve tonight. It says, American history and the emphasis on freedom in our culture may cause us to miss Paul's point in these scriptures. Political and religious freedom mean nothing if we are enslaved to sin. Amen? Would you stand tonight? Father, we're so grateful for your word and your teachings. Lord, help us to remember, Lord, to give to those who are around us. Not always to be taking, but Father, to be giving. Lord, help us to remember to be enslaved in your service, Father. I would rather be a servant in your courts. Father, help us, God, to choose which path we're going to walk and stay in that path. And give us the strength and the presence of mind. Give us the self-control that we need to be who we need to be for you, Father, to further your kingdom. And we give you all glory and praise tonight. The church says,
amen.
Amen.